Nothing beats talking about a Halloween movie in October, aka the Spooky Mama Month, with the set decorated to match the atmosphere. Let's get into the movie. Halloween H2O 20 years later, or Halloween 20, 20 years later, if you want to be literal. Well, I guess if you want to be literal, it's technically Halloween water 20 years later. Boy, was dehydrated for 20 years. Is a Halloween film I believe is beloved for many Michael Myers fans for a couple of reasons. One of the obvious ones being is Jamie Lee Curtis, our final girl from the original movie, makes her return to the franchise. This being such a huge selling point for the movie and really the kick in the butt it needed to get the franchise back up and running since the last film, Halloween 6, The Curse of Michael Myers, bombed financially and with critics. Having this seventh movie almost be a direct-to-video sequel, the studio wanted to do everything in their power to make sure that this would become a huge success, even enlisting Kevin Williamson to be part of the making of this movie. Now, if that name isn't familiar to you, it really should be, because that is the man responsible for writing the first Scream movie. Kevin Williamson was brought on because of the success of Scream being one of the biggest slasher movies ever made, proving there is still an appetite out there for these types of movies. All their chips seem to be in order, but the only problem they were facing is that Laurie Strode was technically dead in the current Halloween timeline. This is where director Stephen Miner, who worked on some previous Friday the 13th sequels, made the tough decision to just erase Halloween 4, 5, and 6 from canon and make Halloween H2O a direct sequel to Halloween 2, branching off a whole new timeline for Michael Myers where the character of Jamie never existed and Michael Myers' motivation and background no longer connected to the Thorn cult, leaving his motivations as a pure evil being who wants to get rid of his own family. It's a conflicting choice for sure because Jamie is one of my favorite characters in the Halloween franchise, and to completely erase her timeline and everything about that character does make me sad, but the movie speaks for itself. So continuing the road to Halloween Kills, let's dive into the next Halloween movie on the list, Halloween H2O 20 years later. So with the opening of Halloween 20 years later, we don't get any fancy opening title cards as we've gotten in the past. Instead, we get the Mr. Sandman song playing in the background, bringing us back to the ending and beginning of Halloween 2, where that same song was playing and showing our first bit of influence that Kevin Williamson had from bringing a little bit of the Scream vibes as this movie basically opens up with an opening kill very similar to how every Scream movie opens up. We're now located in Langdon, Illinois, where we refollow the character of Nurse Marion, who you should remember as accompanying Dr. Loomis in the opening of John Carpenter's Halloween, and also was the person to inform Dr. Loomis that Laurie Strode is actually the sister of Michael Myers. And this is where my respect really comes in for Halloween H2O, because this movie is not only a love letter to other slasher movies, but also a movie that really feels like it was built for fans of Michael Myers, as this film just has endless references to things that made Michael Myers iconic and legacy characters. Nurse Marion notices that someone has broken into her home, being scared of whoever might be inside, decides to go to her neighbor's house where we meet a young Jason Voorhees? Oh, that's just Joseph Gordon-Levitt. But this is what I meant about this movie also being a bit of a love letter to other horror movies, because that was an obvious nod to Jason Voorhees. And even when Nurse Marion is knocking on another couple of doors, you see one of the Hellraiser Cenobites, I really don't know how to say it, I just call them demon bros, on the porch there sitting in the background. Just fun little things that horror fans would love to see and catch. Nurse Marion, not feeling a little bit safe around these teenage boys, decides to ask them if they can go check out if her house is safe, not worrying about their lives. But after Joseph Gordon-Levitt's character checks out the place and steals some beer, lets her know that it's perfectly safe and you're fine to go in, the intruder must have left. Nurse Marion, taking this kid's word for it, decides to go in and realizes that it's her office that was mainly attacked as someone was looking into the file of Laurie Strode. Her having a shocking revelation of knowing exactly what this must mean, decides to run back to Batman and Robin only to see that Michael has gotten to them first. Having the shape Michael Myers reappear in front of Nurse Marion for the first time in 20 years, and wow, the boy looks great. It looks like they kept the mask from Halloween 6 in this movie. Awesome. I love that mask. That was a great mask. Hope they don't change it throughout this movie. Mama, And I gotta admit, this whole setup and battle that happens between Nurse Marion and Michael Myers is so well done, but also just so very reminiscent to the Scream opening, where Drew Barrymore is trying to call out for help from someone across from them, but can't because the killer is right there. Even the fights they have between them, Michael is really taking up the Ghostface karate lessons and is getting his butt whooped by Nurse Marion. If I had a nitpick, that's probably some of the stuff with Scream I wouldn't give to Michael Myers, especially since this is a character built up on being outrageously strong for his size. To see a little old nurse kick you around, Mikey, it don't give me the vibes that you're strong in this movie. Sadly, Michael Myers does win this round, killing off Nurse Marion, but that won't be the last time she'll be killed in the Halloween franchise, I bet. With Nurse Marion gone and Michael now having the information he needs to get to Laurie Strode, he decides to steal her car and head his way over to where she's located. And at this point, man, I'm just kind of disappointed. We have so much Michael Myers merch out there and not one toy or figure of the boy sitting in the car. The man literally performs GTA in every other movie. You would think by now we would have some sort of figure or toy where he's sitting at the steering wheel driving. I mean, they even made a pop of him in his house. I need this boy to either show up as a DLC on Mario Kart or be the next villain in Fast and Furious, because the man just loves getting behind a wheel. But as Michael is driving off to find Laurie Strode, his sister, we get some much needed exposition needed for the audience to realize this is a brand new timeline, with the officer here spoon feeding us a little bit. We find out that Nurse Marion was actually the nurse taking care of Dr. Loomis until his final days, seeing that he was still very much obsessed with Michael Myers and also believed that he was still out there since his body was never recovered. But it does leave me as a Halloween fan with the burning question of how did Michael survive that? Also, where has he been for 20 years? Did he go and recreate his outfit and then just chill around? Because his mask was burnt at the end of Halloween 2, where this movie takes place from. All lingering questions that are really just breezed over and you kind of just have to ignore and let go and be like, look, he's just back. He's got his outfit. Can you just accept that, okay? But I do love how they have to throw this line into it.
You tell him to look for a guy with a cane and Alzheimer's. The guy would be younger than I am, okay? I was 15 when he killed his sister back in 63.
Kind of just to let the audience know, look, I know it's been 20 years, but Michael's still young and spry and can go killing. I mean, it's not like we did it 40 years later. Bringing us now finally back to Laurie Strode for the first time in 20 years, this movie updating us with what this new timeline has set up. Instead of Laurie Strode giving birth to Jamie and dying mysteriously, in the new timeline Halloween H2O sets up, Laurie Strode went ahead and faked her death, changed her name to Carrie Tate, is the headmaster of a private boarding school, also is divorced with a now 17-year-old son named John, who I'd like to assume was named John after John Carpenter. This boarding school that Jamie Lee Curtis's character works at is also located in a fictional town of Summer Glen, California, being one of the first Halloween movies to take us out of Haddonfield. And you know what? I don't mind this. This location, this setup, this boarding school is a nice refreshing change of pace and kind of exactly what the Halloween franchise needed to feel a little different and modernized. And although John and his mother do have a good relationship, as it appears here around this time of year, Halloween is when things get a little rocky between them, especially when John wants to go on the school field trip to Yosemite and his mother not allowing him because of her paranoia and fear that Michael might show up. Thankfully, John is in good company because his girlfriend Molly and friend Charlie and Sarah decide they're gonna skip the school field trip and instead stay behind with their friend to just have a little fun time together. Cutting us back to where Michael Myers is on his current road trip to Laurie Strode, where we see he's driven so far he's burnt out his tires. And look, this is where I gotta call BS a little bit in this movie, all right? Well, I think it's a really great touch to show that Michael was driving so hard and fast that he eventually just burnt out his tires and had to stop at this random bathroom in the middle of nowhere. The boy drove from Langdon, Illinois, all the way to Summer Glen, California, which would be a 1 day and 3 hour trip in a car. And I'm just having a hard time Michael Myers pulled that trip off without a couple of things happening along the way. Thankfully, a mother and a daughter have driven in a very creepy looking vehicle, with Michael in there as well, in what I think is a very tense scene, especially because you also feel the fear the mother must have for her daughter in the next stall, as she sees through the little crack that is always embarrassing in public areas. Thankfully though, Michael only wanted the keys and decides to drive off. Another curious situation with Michael and how he decides and picks his victims. Cause sometimes to me, if it seems like they're not even a worthy opponent or a good enough fight for Mikey, he doesn't even bother with going after them. Cutting back to Laurie Strode, who's defying HR rules and is hooking up with the school's guidance counselor, Will. Will is a great all-around guy for Laurie. Unfortunately, Will only knows Laurie as Carrie Tate. Laurie, hating the fact that this relationship is built on the lie, feels like she needs to inform him of her past, but just can't seem to do it without a couple of drinks in her system. We also then meet the school security guard that, oh my god, is that? That's LL Cool J! LL Cool J plays a security guard campus, Ronnie, who dreams of being an erotic fiction writer?
They climbed high up a skirt, leading to two tumultuous round melon breasts.
Round melon? What?
Of course you didn't like it. You said melons. This is the Michael Myers franchise. We talk about women with cookie breasts. Did you not see Halloween 5? John and Charlie interrupt the man's fiction by sweet-talking him into letting them walk off campus so they can buy a couple of items for their little fun they'll have this weekend.
Don't you do me wrong, okay?
Not a chance, man.
Get out of here. All right. Get out.
Comb your hair.
And I'm actually really glad he said that. I don't know why. I can't stand John's hair. But now that the boys are in town and stealing some booze, as teenagers love to do, Laurie does catch her son losing her effing lid.
What the fuck do you think you're doing?
Mom, I'm really uncomfortable with you saying that
Well,
word.
Then don't put me in the position, John.
And you know what? Maybe this isn't fair to me to say, but knowing how Halloween 2018 handles the character of Laurie and that version of her being paranoid and always scared of Michael coming after her, I really appreciate the way Laurie is in Halloween H2O, where you can obviously tell she's an overprotective parent, is scared of Michael coming back someday, but it's never really to the point where it looks like it's completely ruined her life. I mean, she still has an okay relationship with her son, even if they fight over Halloween, but she ended up with a good career, has friends. I think it's the perfect balance that one stalker killer would have if he only met you for one night, as opposed to the very extreme paranoia she has in 2018. But we'll get to that movie eventually. Laurie then taking her son and her friend back to the school, about to turn this man to LL Spank J, bringing us to a class that Laurie teaches that has her son and Molly in the same room. Again, giving more callbacks and references to the previous Halloween movie where you have a girl look out the window, see Michael's there, but not completely distracted from class where she can still give the correct answer. But Laurie after class then has a change of heart and realizes that it's been 17 years, Michael has not shown up, he probably never will again, deciding to finally let off the leash of her son so that he's free to go on the Yosemite trip and continue living his life, and Laurie can begin the process of getting over Michael. But it's a little too late for John, as he's already made these plans with his friends and still decides not to go on the Yosemite trip, staying behind in school to hang out with his friends. As Laurie assumes she's watching her son drive off to the Yosemite trip, where then she encounters her secretary, who is actually Jamie Lee Curtis's real-life mom, Janet Lee Curtis, that also was one of the stars of Psycho. Another fun little Easter egg thrown in there for horror fans. Doubling down on it more when she recites a famous line from the first Halloween movie.
It's Halloween, I guess. Everyone's entitled to one good scare.
You know, it's Halloween. I guess everyone's entitled to one good scare, huh?
Yes, sir.
But now that the sun is down and it's Halloween night, it is time for Michael to go with striking, having his first test be getting past campus security, LL Cool J. I do think it's funny though, even though Michael has already gotten past the security guard and can continue walking, he still decides to be popping in and out of the windows, like if he's heard snippets of this man's fanfiction and wants to know more. But now with Michael on campus, he does start to stalk his sister, Laurie just thinking it's her mind playing tricks on her again, dismissing it as nothing as guidance counselor Will goes ahead and checks up on the remaining students that didn't go to the field trip, where these girls are enjoying Scream 2, but it's also weird because the first Scream movie, they were watching Halloween, causing a bit of a paradox where Michael Myers exists in the real world and their movie world? I don't care. It was still a cool Easter egg. What I do care about, though, is this.
Sounds good.
Care to join us?
I can't. I'm having my nipples pierced.
Oh.
But you two have a good time.
Kind of guidance counselor talks like that to his students. Everything now seems in order to have a perfect Halloween night as John and his friends are cooking leftover cafeteria food. Yum! And Lori drinking a bottle of wine with her current boyfriend, Will, where she thinks it's finally time to open up about her past. In the middle of this conversation, they do kind of drop a hint to how Michael Myers is now finally back.
How old were you?
17.
As Lori realized that Michael killed his first sister when she was 17, then came after Lori at the age of 17, and now her own son is also 17, making it seem like that's the magic number where Michael decides to reappear, and for what reason? Who the hell knows? This would imply that again, Michael Myers still has some sort of psychic connection linked to the Strode family, where he can just sense that they are out there living and existing and he needs to find them. But even then, that's a little confusing, because if they have that psychic link, why would he even need to go to Nurse Marion to locate files on Lori to see where she's located? Because if he has the knowledge that she has a 17-year-old son, why wouldn't he just have the knowledge of knowing where she's at? But 7 to 6 movies in with Michael Myers, we don't ask questions, we just accept what's given to us now. Lori springing into action with this new information, popping out a gun very similar to the one Loomis had in the first Halloween movie, realizing that her son never went on the Yosemite trip and needs to find him on campus. Too bad Michael has already gone to John's friends.
Lights up, Charlie. No sex games till I've eaten.
In what is a really cool setup, a kid sticking his hand in the garbage disposal, thinking at any moment it's gonna be turned on, only to see Michael pop up behind the kid. And it's about damn time, because now we're an hour into the movie, and the last kill we had was Nurse Marion in the very beginning, and seeing that awesome mask he had, I'm ready to see this boy go after it, and oh my god! What the heck is that? That, my friends, is the first and only CGI mask that Michael Myers has worn in his franchise. And the reason for this happening is because the studio and directors just could not make up their minds on what mask Michael Myers should wear for this movie. The studio originally wanted them to just keep the same mask that Michael was wearing in Halloween 6, The Curse of Michael Myers, which I 100% agree because the mask in Halloween 6 is perfect. But for some reason, director Stephen Miner hated that mask and wanted to create his own mold, first coming out with this egghead looking mask that's in front of me. This is the mask that they used for about 3 weeks of filming until the studio was just getting daily clips of the movie and realizing, boy, Michael looks like he's Humpty Dumpty. We need to get rid of this thing. Then swapping it with the mask you'll see most often in this movie that still isn't all that great because it is a little too tight on the face. The eye holes are really huge, leaving the eyes super exposed. And in one of the only scenes in the movie that they couldn't refilm the new mask with was this one where they were promised we can take care of it with CGI. No, you couldn't. And you know me, I'm collecting the masks as I go through all the Halloween movies. So talking about the one in Halloween H2O, it really shows you how big of a difference the mask can have vice versa. In where Halloween 6, The Curse of Michael Myers, that is a bad movie that did a lot of horrible things for Michael. But when you have Michael in a mask and an actor whose body posture really captures the shape, you can still find a lot of enjoyment out of that character and feel real fear for Michael, making a bad movie like Halloween 6 way more watchable. And now in this instance with Halloween H2O, in what I consider to be a pretty good or decent movie, is slightly hindered by that awful mask and an actor who is just not portraying the body movements of Michael Myers very well. This guy comes off a lot shorter, moves very awkwardly towards the camera. Like in this scene, for instance, after Sarah has found her boyfriend Charlie dead in the dumbwaiter, putting her on the run from Michael Myers and trying to escape. This sequence itself is really cool and almost feels like an updated version from the laundry chute scene in Halloween 5, making me really feel bad and scared for this character who gets her leg crushed. But then making me go back to it feeling silly when you get that Michael Myers face and those awkward body movements of him stabbing Sarah. This just does not feel threatening or that scary, and almost just like a cosplayer imitating Michael Myers movements in a bad way. Johnny and Molly did hear all the ruckus, deciding to go investigate, thinking that their friends are about to pull a horrible prank on them, until they find Sarah's body hung up in a scene very similar to the way Drew Barrymore's body was hung up in the beginning of Scream. John finally encountering his uncle Michael Myers, and again just further proving my point that this actor just does not have Michael handled. As he's doing the famous head tilt, it just does not look right. Our characters then running off, but good old Michael Myers still being able to catch up with them. Close to ending Molly's life, John springs into action, and you know what? This scene kicks ass. I love the reaction John had and was like, all right, let's see how tough you are and if everything my mother said about you is true. Just taking swing after swing at Michael. And again, it's just more of that Scream influence where the slasher can be easily knocked down by his victims. Even though, again, we've established Michael is this being with just ungodly strength that really shouldn't be knocked down so easily. But I'll forgive it because this is the only sequence in the movie that actually makes the Halloween H2O mask look badass with the way he gets up. John and Molly then finally finding Laurie Strode telling her that everything she feared is true, bringing us to the most iconic shot of the movie. All bets are now finally off. Laurie has been waiting for this moment for 20 years, not even missing a beat to some of the things she said in the first Halloween movie.
Barricade the door. Lock it. Do as I say now!
With even having her boyfriend Will convinced that this is a problem and that he's gonna be the hero to save the day, shooting Michael. Oh no! LL Cool J! No! I assume for a slight moment this was a reference to the Halloween franchise. They just love continuing to kill off innocent characters out of fear, because that's what happened to Ben Tramer. And another citizen of Haddonfield by the drunk Avengers, LL Cool J would have just been another one of those victims. And in the Halloween franchise, no sin goes unpunished, with Michael showing up behind Will, stabbing him in the back. As again, another reference to a famous Michael Myers move in Halloween 2 when he did that to a nurse. And you know what? I kind of love these references. It's almost like Michael Myers is a video game character and he only has a certain set of moves. It's just funny to me that the same people who love and admire Halloween H2O are the same people who will then go on to criticize Halloween 2018 for having too many callbacks, too many references. Halloween H2O is the exact same thing. And heck, H2O kind of even doubles down on it, because look.
Police. No, we're not leaving.
Go as I say now.
She literally just said that line like 5 minutes ago in the movie, and now we're referencing it a second time? Okay. But here is where Halloween H2O for me went from being a good movie to an awesome film, as Laurie Strode knows her brother very well and that he'll come back no matter what, goes back to the school with an axe, ready to face off her brother in what is the rematch Halloween fans have been waiting for all these years. And it looks like Michael was training for this battle too. The man could do one-arm pull-ups? Damn! Michael, I'm gonna need you to drop that workout routine. But as the battle begins, we have yet another callback to the Halloween franchise where Michael reopens the wound he first gave Laurie back in the first movie. Having this epic battle continue throughout different rooms in the school, the mess hall, inside the kitchen where Laurie's trying to play some sort of carnival game and misses every shot at Michael, but eventually still finding a way to get the upper hand on her brother and what seems to be ending him for good. I just love the fighting spirit Laurie had in Halloween H2O, because it's exactly the pent-up rage you would think she'd have from all these years of living in fear. She finally gets to explode that out, and because she never really got to battle Michael before, it's just so nice to see this rematch done. But right when Laurie is finally deciding to end her brother off for good, we get to see,
don't call it a comeback, I've been here for damn,
he's alive! The cops then coming in, taking Michael Myers' body away. LL Cool J now gonna write some freaky Michael Myers fanfiction that I'm still waiting for that book, man. I wanna read that. And even though he appears to be dead, she knows if he's in one piece, there's a very good chance he'd come back. Pulling a crazy Loomis, stealing a gun from a cop, driving away with the body of Michael, doing exactly what she needs to make sure he'll end, like maybe a callback to Halloween 4? I will say the only callbacks this movie did not get right is the way Michael Myers stands back up. The guy must only be working out his arms because he needs a little bit of work on his core. But now that the van has rolled down the hill, pinning Michael between the van and a tree, Laurie taking one last look at her brother, having a little bit of moment of closure, reaching out her hand, only for then to her finally axe off the head of Michael Myers in what should have been the end of the franchise. I remember seeing this for the very first time and just being so shocked to hell, because you know you're watching these movies, they've made 7 of them, you assume they'll probably make 7 more, and seeing Michael's head just finally come off, you're like, wow, They ended it. They did it. This is over. But if you're a fan of the franchise, you know, again, this death is not permanent, and boy, do they have a way to explaining it. But I think Halloween H2O was a great refreshing change for the franchise, successfully bringing back Laurie Strode, updating Michael Myers for a bit of a modern audience, which would explain why this movie was mega successful and why the studio would want to make more, which even the explanation they give in the next movie, how Michael Myers comes back, would have been fine with me if they had a good story to tell with these same recurring characters, but they don't do that. But that is just Halloween H2O. I really want to know your guys' opinions on this movie. I think most people do like this movie, but I'd love hearing from the people who hate this film. Always love hearing from you Halloween fans, but I'll catch you on the next Halloween review.